GettingPositiveKarmaNow.com presents Bhagavad Gita for All, lectures by Nalin K. Narula, recorded in front of a live audience.
Om Ajnanam Timirandasya Jnanam Janashlakya Chakshurunvigatam Yena Tasmai Shri Guru Namah. Last time we had completed text number 9 of chapter 15, Yoga of the Supreme Person, Purushottam Yoga. And the continuity was that the soul, this is from 15.7, Krishna is saying that the individual soul, spirit soul, they are certainly the separated particles and potencies of His, and that these entities are eternal, but under the influence of the three material modes of nature, they are situated in a conditioned form of life. They have adopted and therefore are struggling with the five senses and the mind, which is the sixth sense. They are in delusion or in an illusory state. And 15.8 was that any bodily form that the soul enters and from which it departs to enter another, the soul as a master of the body carries with it these six subtle senses and the impressions that they have created, just as the air carries the fragrance of a flower from its source to another place. So your karma and your mind and your intelligence, false ego, all travel to the next body according to the activities that the person has done, and he gets those accordingly. And then 15.9 was Shrotram Chakshu Sparshanam Cha Rasanam Grihanam Evacha Adishthaya Manaschayam Vishayan Upasevati. So, having entered a material body, the living entity, the living being, presides over the ears, the eyes, the skin, tongue, nose, and mind, and enjoys the sense objects of the sound, form, touch, taste, and smell. So it is engaged in that activity under the influence of the three material modes of nature. So today we have text 15.10. Utkramantam sthitam vapi bhunjanam va gunavitam vimudha nanupashyanti pashyanti jnana chakshusa. So utkramantam sthitam va api bhunjanam va guna anvitam. So whether the living entity is in the body or it has departed the body, it has left the body. Utkramantam means who has left the body. Va api, either enjoying it, guna anvitam, according to the sense objects and the senses that are drawn to the sense objects under the influence of material nature. Vimudha na anupashyanti. The deluded and foolish person cannot see this. But pashyanti jnana chakshusa. But this is, this can be seen by those who have the eyes of spiritual intelligence. The deluded and foolish cannot see the soul when it leaves the body, nor when it is in the body, nor when it is enjoying the body through its senses and its objects under the influence of the material modes of nature, but one who has the eyes of spiritual intelligence can see this. So, spiritual intelligence is required for this. And it doesn't mean that one automatically has it, because you may be technically connected to spiritual intelligence, but if you are not using it, then it's of no use. And that is what Sri Krishna is explaining in the next sloka in 15.11. Yatanto yoginash chainam pasyanti atmani avasthitam yatanto api akritatmano nainam pasyanti achitasa. Yatanta yogina, among the different types of yogis, the sincere seekers situated in self-realization, they can see the soul self within. Enam pashyati atmani, avasthitam. Those who are situated in the self-realization aspect, they can see the soul self within, through these eyes of intelligence. They're not seeing through the material eyes, they're seeing through the spiritual eyes of intelligence. And then, yatanta api akrita atmana. So, akrita atmana means those who do not have controlled senses and who are without self-realization. So, those who lack self-control cannot see this, even if they are making efforts. Even if they are making efforts. Why? Because achetasa, because their minds and understanding are undeveloped. So, this is a misdirected mentality. So a person may be connected, so Krishna makes it very clear, just because somebody is connected to the self-realization path, he is a yogi or he is apparently a yogi, where they are seeking to link with the divine, but actually they are not linking because they are using all this for material benefits. They may be doing some bodybuilding, they may be doing some exercises, yogi exercises for getting some physical benefit, or in the case of the initial stages of those who are connected even to the healing modalities, they're using these not so much for self-realization but for bettering their place in life. So these people are not sincere and persevering. And they are not self-controlled because their minds and understandings are undeveloped. So this is a very basic stage if somebody is there and is not simultaneously upgrading himself or herself to the understanding of self-realization of the science of the soul, is not able to understand what is karma and that actions have consequences and what is the right way to act, they are then having a misdirected mentality. So that mentality needs to be rectified and corrected, and then only one can progress, because coming to the point of understanding or connecting with the Supreme directly is not a simple matter. It is simple if you let go of all these ideas about get away from these ideas about sense enjoyment and making your material conditions better. So there needs to be a point where you work more towards gaining your inner realizations regardless of your material nature. So under the influence of the material nature it is not possible, but as spiritual intelligence increases, one can persevere, yatanta. Yatanta means persevering, sincere. That you are still continuing, regardless of everything, to seek this aspect of being in the self. Controlling your senses and being situated in the mode of self-realization, realizing who the soul is, who you really are. In other words, not in the bodily consciousness alone. So looking at the inner spiritual consciousness. So among the different types of yogis who are looking for yogic connections, the sincere seekers are situated in self-realization and can see the soul self within. Those who lack self-control cannot see this even if they are making efforts, because their minds and understanding are not developed to that extent. So they are not able to understand, even though they are associating with other yogis and people who are in that journey, but they are not actually participating. Then we have text 15.12 through 14, that is a particular sequence. Yad aditya gatam tejo jagat bhasyate akhilam yat chandramasi yat cha agnau tat tejo vidhi mam kam gam avishya cha bhutani dharyami aham ojasa pushnami chausadhi sarva सोम भूत्वा रसात्मका, अहम वैश्वानरो भूत्वा प्राणिनाम देहम आश्रिता प्रणापान समायुक्त पचामी अन्नम चतुर्विधम। स्टार्टिंग विद 15:12, यद आदित्य गतम तेजो जगद भास्यते अखिलम, यत चंद्रमसी यत चाग्नौ तत् तेजो विद्धि मामकम। The effulgent splendor of the sun that illuminates the entire universe, the light that is in the moon, and the brilliant heat and splendor of fire all come from me. So all the brilliance, the teja, yat aditya gatam, the effulgent splendor of the sun that illuminates the whole world, jagat bhasyate akhilam, entire world, entire universe, cosmos, yet chandramasi, that light which is in the moon, that is also coming from me, and also is coming from me. Agnau tat teja, the brilliant heat and splendor of fire is also coming from me. You should understand, vidhi mamakam, which is coming from me alone. Then 15:13 is, gam avishya cha bhutani dharyami aham ojasa pushnami chaushadhi sarva soma bhutva rasatmaka. Gam means the planets and the earth specifically, the place of karmic action, reaction and activity. Avishya cha bhutani, I enter that, and also the bhutani means the living entities. Dharyami, I maintain and sustain, aham, I. Ojasa, by my spiritual potency, by my power, by my potency. Pushnami, I nourish. Cha aushadhi, and also I nourish the plants, the herbs and the vegetables. Sarva soma bhutva rasatmaka, all of these I nourish by becoming the moon, and by the moon's life-giving rays I enter the plants and I give them the juice of life, and so nourish everyone. So the natural food for human beings, in fact for every living entity, is directly or indirectly plants, herbs and vegetables. So even those who are the carnivorous animals, they are eating other animals whose bodies are created out of plant food. So ultimately the plant food is the basic sustainer, and it is the rays of the moon that give the flavor and the taste and the life-giving energy. So without the moon's rays, the plants don't grow properly and they are having a problem in their growth. So many scientific tests have been done that during the dark phase of the moon, the plant's growth slows down. During the bright phase, it speeds up. So modern science also is finding this out gradually. Then the third very important aspect of this whole sustenance sequence of explanation that Krishna is giving Arjuna, 15:14, aham vaish vanaro bhutva praninam deham ashrita pranapan samayukta pachami annam chaturvidham. Aham vaish vanara. Vaish vanara is the fire of digestion. Bhutva means becomes. So I become, Krishna says, I enter the bodies of the living entities, praninam. Praninam deham. I enter to the bodies of the living entities. He is now talking about the physical body. Earlier it was, the explanation has been given that the super soul accompanies the soul, and now he is also entering the body as the fire of digestion. Krishna is entering the body as the fire of digestion. And prana apana samayukta. So situated in this body, the living entity, deham ashrita, praninam deham ashrita, prana apana, the outgoing air and the incoming air. So the prana is rising upward and the apana is going downward. So this is a combination of upward and rising. These are two of the 10 main airs. And keeping this in balance, samayukta, balancing this with the fire, all these three things together, the incoming, outgoing air, the breath, and then the fire of digestion. Pachami, I digest. Annam, all the foodstuffs. Chaturvidham, all the four kinds of foodstuffs. So I enter into the bodies of the living entities as the fire of digestion, and acting with the ascending outgoing prana and the inward descending apana life airs, I digest the four kinds of foodstuff, that which is chewed, sucked, licked, and that is drunk. So the food that is chewed is called khadva, that which is sucked is called soshva, licked is leya, and that which is drunk is peya. So these are the four different types of foods that we have. So when you chew and then swallow, that is one type of food. And if you suck something like, let's say, something from a fruit, or you suck the juice of the fruit, or you lick something like honey and molasses and stuff like that, and then you drink things which are not requiring chewing and nothing, it goes down easily because it is liquid, so liquid food. So these are four types of foods that are eaten, and all these are digested through the fire of digestion in combination with the airs. So to go back to 1510, what is, we will pause here at 1514, and we will just quickly review that the deluded and foolish cannot see the soul when it leaves the body, nor when it is in the body, nor when it is enjoying the body through its senses and its objects under the influence of the material modes of nature. But one who has the eyes of spiritual intelligence can see this. That was 1510, and then 1511 is among the different types of yogis who are making efforts of various kinds to proceed on that path. The sincere seekers situated in self-realization can see the soul self within. Those who lack control cannot see this, even though they are trying and they are making efforts, because their minds and understandings are undeveloped, so their mentality is misdirected. Then he is saying that I enter into the sun and the moon and fire, these are my energies, the effulgent splendor of the sun which illuminates the entire universe, the light that is the moon, and the brilliant heat and splendor of fire all come from me. And then in 1513, entering the plants and the earth, I maintain and sustain all living entities by my potency, and by becoming the moon, and through its life-giving rays I provide the essential nourishing juice of life in plants, herbs and vegetables. So Gam Avishya, I enter the planet. So he is entering into every molecule and every atom of the planet, also of the earth. So that potency is also there. So he is everywhere in order to create the nourishment to sustain the living entities is happening. Also, by his potency, he is keeping the planets afloat in space. There is no apparent energy why the planet should be floating. So they are floating also entirely because of Krishna's Ojasa. He says Ojasa by his potency. So he is keeping the planets afloat, he is keeping the living entities alive and afloat, so to speak, in their bodies. And he enters the body in 1514. He's saying, I enter the bodies of the living entities, those who have taken shelter of the bodies, and I am the fire of digestion that works in coordination with the outgoing prana and the incoming descending apana life airs, digesting the four kinds of foodstuff, that which is chewed, sucked, licked and drunk. All the digestion process is going on automatically in the body under the direction of the fire of digestion, and the intelligence, the health-giving intelligence of the body. Okay, so we will pause here at text 1514, and if there are any questions, we will take some questions now.
So first time understanding about what we eat through various means like chew and other licking and other means, this is important to us.
Well, it is an understanding that how your digestion works. It is giving some additional information that there are four types of food that you eat. the manner of eating the food is given. All the four types of foods that you eat. So even if you drink water, that also has to be digested. So that digestion is also taking place. If you drink juice, that has to be digested. So all manner of digestion is taking place because of the fire of digestion and the airs of the apana and the prana, vayu. The prana vayu is significant because your heart chakra floats in the prana vayu. That is where the living entity is. So the prana is always rising and the apana is keeping you grounded. So if your downward air is not working properly, then the process of elimination of wastes from the body is not happening. So the indication here is that different types of food you eat is digesting, and by extension any disturbance of these is going to create ill health. If there is a mismatch of these, then there is a ill health. So your body will react to those situations. This is some additional information. Yes.
How do we control, like you said, that if you don't have the control?
Yes, self-control, which means that my senses are not in control. I'm not controlling my senses. I'm not following any practices to control my senses. Whatever I see, I want to run and grab it. That is the sight. Whatever I hear, I want. Whatever form I see, I want to have it. I want to acquire it. I want to enjoy my senses. So there has to be a certain control. So how is that control coming? That control comes when you work with the healing energies of Reiki and you are chanting, let's say, the Maha Mantra. So gradually your senses get attracted to the divine. By chanting the Maha Mantra, your mind and your consciousness rises upwards towards the divine. So Krishna is saying that those who do not have their minds and consciousness engaged in self-realization, they have a problem. So the fastest way to quickly connect yourself is by chanting the Maha Mantra. So once you chant the Maha Mantra and you are doing your healing, then gradually all these things fall into place. If you are missing out the chanting of the names of the divine, you are missing out on being connected directly and instantly to all the potencies of the divine. Then you are working with the karmic healing energies of Reiki or the Brahmin energies, the Brahminical energies of Reiki. So it's a very powerful combination. So when you combine the two, then you are very quickly situated. Self-control starts to happen fairly naturally as you proceed in this process. So when you are eating food that is offered to the divine or it is imbued with the energy of the divine as a blessing, then that food nourishes your higher intelligence. So that means I am going to eat the right kind of foods. So what are those foods? Those foods are, and this will be discussed later on again detail in the Bhagavad Gita, but those are foods that are not creating disturbance for your digestion and also not having gross karmic reactions. So the gross karmic reactions come from the type of food that you eat. For example, if you are eating animal food, that is a gross type of karmic reaction coming. So going beyond the next level is, okay, I will eat only vegetables, because here it is stated in this sequence from 15:12 to 14. In 15:13 it says that Krishna enters the vegetables and he is giving the life nourishing juice and flavor and the energy, the potency of the vegetables to sustain life. So if I'm eating those kind of foods, that's the next level. But the higher level is that I'm channeling healing to all of this to make it karma free. And I'm offering to Krishna, back to him, thanking him, in other words, being in a state of gratitude that all this is coming from you. Food is not something that we can create. Food is something that is created by Krishna's nature. So having all those understandings, either in the background or in the forefront, or it travels back and forth, that makes you more Krishna conscious, that makes you more aware of the presence of Krishna everywhere, that he is saying, I am there in every atom. He says that I enter Kam Avishya, I enter into all the planets and the Bhutani living entity Dharyami, I sustain them. He is sustaining through everything, the light, the electricity, the fire, the sun, the moon, the water, the crops, everything is coming from him. So he is entered into everything to create a situation to give us a very comfortable life position that we can sustain ourselves easily through these things. We don't have to make huge efforts. And we can be more engaged in following our natural purpose of yoginam, trying to be among all the yogis, being the yogis that are following the transcendental path of self-control and self-realization. So understanding of the soul and the spirit aspect, how that works, and understanding how where the soul needs to go. So when you get that in the forefront, then other things start to lose their relative importance. It's not that they are unimportant, it is just that they have become relatively unimportant. Whatever our obligations are, we must maintain and fulfill. But we don't have to make endless plans for futures which we are never going to see. Otherwise, we are building sandcastle lives on the shores of time, which will be destroyed. Those are no use eventually. Only use is if you are engaged in this path. Then you are making use of your life. Otherwise, you are not. Where you will be after you leave this body, if you have not prepared for the next position, then you are going to be in a sorry state. Then it is very unstable. It is not necessary to take human life after this life. I would recommend to you to study this 1511 very deeply. 1510 and 1511. Utrakamantam sthitam vapi bhunjanam va gunanvitam vimudha nanu pashyanti pashyanti jnana chakshusa. The foolish and deluded cannot see the soul when it leaves the body, nor when it's in the body, and nor when it is enjoying the body through its senses and its objects under the influence of the material modes of nature. But one who has the jnana chakshus, the spiritual intelligence eyes to see, such a one can see. And then 1511, yatanto yoginas chainam pashyanti atmani avasthitam yatanto api akritatmano nainam pashyanti achetasa. So among the different types of yogis who are on the path of self-realization, only those who are the sincere seekers situated in self-realization can see the soul self within and who are controlled. So those who lack self-control cannot see this even though they make the efforts, because their minds and understanding are undeveloped. So their mentality is misdirected towards material ends rather than the spiritual. Because there will be a point when you are, even as a healer, as a Reiki channel, there is no unlimited improvement of your material condition. Please understand that. It is a great illusion and delusion that if you think I will infinitely improve my material life, it's not happening. It cannot. But the healing puts you in a position to be yoginam, where you are the sincere and persevering yogis. The yatanta yogina cha enam pashyanti atmani avasthitam, situated. You have to be situated in this understanding that this is a facility given to you to improve your immediate material life so that you can do this, that you can proceed in the process of self-realization. As the body gets older, the senses influence also starts to decrease, except for the mind. The mind hankers for so many things, but the body is not capable. As the people get older, maybe their digestion process reduces. they are not able to digest, so their food has to become simpler and simpler. But if they insist on eating all that they could eat 40 years ago or 50 years ago, the body is going to be in trouble. Body is going to be in trouble, then there is destruction. Then you are running to the doctors and the physicians and the healers and so on and so forth, not rectifying what you are putting into your body. So similarly, not rectifying what's going on in your life is the same thing in a wider expanded form. So you need to gradually step away from the sense enjoyment, because Krishna has said earlier that those who are under the illusion of material nature, they are busy enjoying the senses, they are not aware of what is going on. On the one hand, you may be aware of what is going on and yet ignore it. I want more. So when you keep wanting more and working for that, you are going to be dissatisfied eventually, because this is at a cross purpose. Reiki healing is not meant to make you a great sense enjoyer. It will satisfy a lot of your requirements. It will improve your senses as you change the way that you behave and live and act. You will be able to, you know, improve your senses, no doubt. But that doesn't mean that there should be uncontrolled activity of those senses, because again then you will fall back into that position of being more focused on sense enjoyment rather than trying to understand that you need to get out of this whole process. So how is that possible? Only when you offer something more superior. The most superior thing you can offer your senses is chanting the names of the God, because it engages all your senses and your mind. The mind is the most tricky of them all. Krishna has said they are battling these five senses, and the sixth sense is the mind. So first is the influence of the material nature in terms of your bodily senses, and then there is the mind who is either out of control, or as a controlled mind he can control the rest of the senses. So if you can fix the mind, you can fix the body. So Cheto Darpanam Marjaram is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. Cleanse the mirror of your consciousness, of your mind. And how do you do that? It's like removing the dust on the mirror. You chant Hare Krishna. So when you chant Hare Krishna, all this dust is going away. So it is very important to combine this activity of healing with chanting. If you don't do that, you are not going to get the ultimate benefit of being a yogi, one who is linked to the divine in reality, in act and deed. Then it is only by, you can say, technical methodology you are a yogi, but you are not a yogi. Krishna makes this very clear. Those without controlled senses and those without understanding the self, they are not yogis. So that is why you have many, very many in on the path who are associating with other yogis, but they are not actually getting anywhere. They are yoga teachers who do not know the first thing about self-realization. The whole point of yoga is to realize the self, to be connected to the divine. If that knowledge is not happening and that understanding is not there, then what is happening? These people are very dissatisfied with their lives. It is only becoming a means of earning something, earning a livelihood. It is not upgrading your consciousness. So upgradation of consciousness is very important.
Is there any restriction when we are chanting the Ma Mantra that we should be seated or can we be moving?
Ma Mantra chanting is unconditional. Any time, place and circumstance. It has no restriction of time, place or circumstance. You could be doing absolutely anything, the same way as healing has no restriction of time, place and circumstance.
We don't have to be focusing that.
You have to focus on the sound is recommended. Otherwise you are chanting like a tape recorder or mechanically. It doesn't help you that much.
Our consciousness may not be on the
problem is, as you work with this, you'll find that your consciousness is in the spiritual, living there, and you're working in the material. So when you live in the spiritual, and you come to work here, you're still living there. But you're descending to this plane to do your work, which is fine. But your consciousness is from some other place. That is the spiritual place where you're connected. So you will find this happening, that when you are dealing with mundane affairs, your day-to-day affairs, there is a part of you which is very different and separate and disconnected in a way, as an observer or just watching what you are doing, and that is in the spiritual space. You may be more focused, your attention may be focused in the present if there is a crisis, if there is an emergency, if there is some threat, something like that, or something is dangerous or it requires your immediate attention. But internally you are connecting to the divine, and that is a matter of practice. So the more you are connected this way, you will actually be... The practice for this is coming, like for example, when you are in an emergency position, you are appealing to Reiki or you are appealing to Krishna. So that is having your consciousness in the divine. Reiki help, Krishna help, you know. Or you just chant the Ma Mantra. So instantly those energies are, your mental energies, your mind is connected there. You are connecting with soul power to that energy. Now whether what happens to your body is a different situation entirely. Whether body is injured, whether it is damaged, whether it is killed, we don't know. But your inner space, your inner consciousness is rising upward.
Shipra has a question.
Yes.
Shipra, you may ask your question.
Good morning, sir.
Hanji, good morning.
Sir, in context of what happened yesterday, I was just thinking, almost I want to say we are all very grateful that we are under your umbrella. And
What happened yesterday? I don't know. What are you talking about? What
happened? Sir, so this Gurmeet Ram Rahim, the destruction that was happening.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I have one question. I want to correct my understanding because that's how I felt. That I was reading also when there was this thing that Kali Yuga is the age of hypocrisy and quarrel. And it's only going to be deteriorating further. And for a moment, I actually felt that, it was so selfish of me to want to become a parent because I wanted to become, but I don't know if it's even a nice thing to bring people into this world because it's only going to deteriorate. I'm not expecting that, my child will not ever suffer, but overall, is there something to be happy about the fact that more people are coming into this world when there's so much madness around?
What is the purpose of a living entity appearing in the world in the human form? Tell me that. What happens when a living entity comes into the world in a human form? What does that mean?
So from my understanding from the class, that if the fact that we are very lucky if we come in the human form.
Yes.
Because then we have the opportunity to understand our relationship with the divine and how to act.
Yes.
And also how to serve him.
Yeah, so you're giving some living entity that opportunity. That is one of the greatest things you can do. So why is it bad? That is the time that living entity is prepared to come. That is his situation in life. And whatever it is, good or bad, they have to face it. But you're giving the opportunity, you're giving the shelter to the living entity in the form of human life. What they make of it is their own karma, their own destiny, and whatever you instill in them in terms of understanding, spiritual and otherwise, and they will make their path accordingly. You have done a good deed. Nothing wrong with that. But if you feel strongly about it, I don't want to have any children, that's also absolutely fine. But once you have them, then don't say, we brought them, what for, and things are so bad, and it's a conscious decision. Now, well, you cannot send a child back, can you? Once he's there. Huh? Once he's out, can you send him back? Huh? Can you? Say, go back to the factory. recalled by head office, like a car, you know. We recall.
I know that he is completely your blessing. I'm not ungrateful for the fact that he is there. I have a child only because of your blessing. Mm. But I was thinking that, sir, I cannot imagine my life without you. Seriously, my life will be meaningless without you. And
when we are here, we are here.
I don't know how he will live.
He will live the same way you have lived. You were born in complete ignorance. At least your son is not so ignorant now, because he has an enlightened mother. So that's a big difference. That's a big advantage he's starting off from. How he uses it, we don't know. That is entirely his choice, his free will. You have done your job and you continue to do it. Nothing wrong with it. Okay, so don't worry for that. It's a good thing you've done. Don't be over thinking it, and don't be over tense that, you know, this is some kind of job that I really have to perform well and I'm not able to perform. Well, you'll perform it the way that you can best, and you have all the support of the healing community and the other healers around you, your friends. We are there. Teachings are there. You just have to follow the methodology and support each other and you'll be fine. Okay? Don't worry.
Great.
All right. Anyone else?
What can parents do with their children?
If they are so empowered, yes, they can.
She's talking about kids. Oh. Very worried about
kids. Already kids.
And husband, yeah, also should be attuned.
No. No, husband should not be attuned by the wife. Because wife becomes guru. So as it is, they are taking that position. And when they formalize it, then that's sure disaster. So it is not recommended that you take attunement from members of your own family. So all the historically, I can't think of any instance of gurus that have given attunement to their own children, or they have not connected. Because the other person can always deal with them more dispassionately. So there has to be that dispassionate connection and unbiased and uninfluenced by familial consideration. Just like it is for a doctor recommended not to treat their own family, especially in serious conditions. Because of the bias and all that, they will not take the right decision. So, the same way, the spiritual master should not be the parent. Although, the parents are the first spiritual masters or guides to their children. The parents are the first gurus. But the formalized relationship should not be, generally is not recommended to have within the family, because there is a lot of emotional upheaval in families, and then this whole exchange, this whole relationship can be upset, and the consequences of that are not so good, because it can create a great obstacle in progress spiritually. Yes.
Sir, and suppose someone gets attuned by you or by somebody else who is also,
yes,
attuned there.
There is no difference in the attunement. There is difference in the realization of the individual as a person on the spiritual path. Guru is one. Guru is one means the same energy is available. What is the position of the guru in his own evolution are different situations. So one guru may be more evolved or less evolved or differently evolved. But the energy is the same. Coming in the lineage, it's the same.
She means that if a husband gets attuned by any of your disciples.
That's fine.
That's what she means.
Yes, but then it depends on, see, if you're comparing that disciple as being equal, yes, in terms of having that position, in terms of having the capability of conveying the energy. Whether that disciple is at the level or beyond or below the master is a different story. Yeah. No, that's actually how you are comparing. if you look at it, you'll say, you know, this is better to get from this person than from that person because that person is more evolved or has demonstrated something more. So that is that person's own evolution. So the guru can be a Kanishta Adhikari, he can be a Madhyam Adhikari, or he can be an Uttam Adhikari. But guru is one in terms of the energy. His own realization and internal development may be different, and it may seem differently. So there may be certain qualities. One of the recommendations is that if you see certain qualities that you want to have, that you're seeing in the guru, then that is a good thing, because then that is how you will develop those qualities. So people are attracted to different gurus for various reasons. So they develop those qualities. In the traditional spiritual system, the gurus are not allowed to initiate anybody until the death of the spiritual master. So once the spiritual master dies, then his empowered students can then initiate others.
So why is that so?
There cannot be many bosses. There can only be one. So that is why even in the... But there are systems where you can give the power of attorney to others who can initiate on your behalf, or they are your students. As was the case when we attuned Renuji. So all her students are my students under power of attorney. So that I made clear on the website also. So that is a Ritvik situation, is known as Ritvik. Means that I'm working under the power and authority. So that is possible. So all the Reiki masters we have created are also actually Ritvik. We have told them that they are actually our students, that you are initiating on our behalf. So I don't think many of them really understand what that means or understood what that means. But this is what it means. That this is a power of attorney, initiation, the students remain ours. They are actually our responsibility in that sense. They are connected to us, yes.
So when you revoke that power, you say now it's no more there. So what happens?
Then those are not mine. Then they are floating wherever they want to go. If they have chosen to become independent, then they are cut off. They have gone away from the service. They are doing the lip service. This is like Krishna has made it clear today, that such people who are not in the proper mode, they are just acting. So they may be associating, but they are not healers or yogis or transcendentalists. They are not considered. Because their minds are misled and deviated. Like that.
Okay. So if they have chosen to become independent, if they are coming to you,
they are fine.
Initiated by
anybody, doesn't matter.
Then it's re-initiation is not required.
Not required at all. Because it's happening under our auspices, so to speak. That's not an issue. So even those who are...
Made a good choice.
Well, you made a choice according to your understanding.
So I was listening to your older recordings and I read your books.
So you're exactly the same. Yeah. What would you say now? Exactly. Obviously, that's what I said, that the 1.5 years...
Yeah, because the basic fundamentals don't change. It is how much you change, then you are able to understand more, or you are able to receive more advanced knowledge. But the foundation is always the same. So it has been the same right from the beginning as far as I am concerned.
Understanding.
Yes. There's no change.
We heard you recently saying the same thing, and I was so surprised. I said that basically I was not prepared, that's all. Mm. That's the only difference I can see. And of course, you took off a massive load of my, my fear. So that was not even allowing me to go one step even doing anything. It was just so scary where am I going? I was so scared. Where was I going?
Down. Actually, that's what I've seen in the group in the last 2 years. Fear is one thing which is kind of in everyone, including
it just
me.
Stops you. Kind of. Snowballs. It's just snowballs.
So you've given us the dignity of living life. You restore it.
See, if you are connecting with the healing and the understanding, you do become fearless. And if you are fearless, it is scary for others. They get very upset. You are not scared. So that is what it means.
Your anger. So that's also, you know, that's the healing energies which are actually showing results in our body consciousness.
Yeah. Achha.
Sir, using what you were saying, keep on hearing it. When I keep on hearing it, I just suddenly realize I'm doing something. Then I said, oh my God, I think I can't even tell you how wonderful it feels that you're doing something and you suddenly realize, you know, you were saying that with. I was hearing another recording and I realized that I had made some, I did something and it was very much in harmony with that. And then I realized that's the reason why I'm so happy now. And I used to never imagine I'll reach anywhere close to this feeling. And
so these are good, these are all signs of being self-controlled. Because the less fear you have, the more self-controlled you are, because you are connecting with the divine, and so that makes you fearless. You are connecting with the soul power, that makes you fearless.
So this is the soul power?
Yeah. Otherwise, how will you become fearless? You are always afraid my position is going to change, or I am in a shaky ground. But if throughout all the shaky grounds I am firm somewhere, that is the only anchor is the divine. And
so
Krishna
knowledge,
consciousness, huh?
Knowledge, I think. I don't know.
Well, at that time, no, knowledge is there, but I'm saying it is a matter of realization, of actualizing that knowledge. Yes. Yeah. So there is the knowledge that you have acquired or learnt, and then there is the realization of that knowledge. So that is self-realization.
That's why I didn't anger or didn't fear, and I was.
Well, you may anger and fear also, but that's,
yeah,
you get over it.
Back,
yeah. So, self-realization is this, that when you are situated in yourself, then you are a much more balanced person. Then you are not disturbed by things that happen around you to the extent of disbalancing you completely. You may be a little bit hurt or upset and all that, but then the recovery is very fast. Because you know that all this is temporary. So, these are all very, very moving and movable and changing, and there is the temporary desirable and then there is the permanent desirable, the eternal desirable. So once you begin to discriminate between the two, that is correct intelligence. So the whole essence of this shloka that Krishna is talking about is that you must be able to discriminate between the temporary, which is the senses, the objects of the senses, the attachments, the three material modes of nature, each of which are fighting for supremacy, sometimes mode of goodness, sometimes mode of passion, and sometimes mode of ignorance. And then there is the spiritual aspect. So these are all combating, and the spiritual is constant. So the more we are situated in constancy of that nature, not stubbornness and all the rest of it, that is, as you know, that is not the same thing. It might appear to be the same thing, but it's not. It is being situated in the spiritual constant and realizing that the material is anything but constant. So there is a changing situation happening all the time. When you are young and your body is growing, you are thinking, you know, I will keep growing like this, the benefit will continue for the rest of my life. And then there are those who know very well, no, you know, in 15 years my body is going to be in a different place. And I will have a different situation to face in life. So these are the time that I can maximize whatever I need to do within this range of activity. Then will come some other range. That's very intelligent, actually, if somebody can do that. And that's not possible without proper understanding and guidance. And being fearless, because people don't want body change. They do anything not to change the body. They'll go to the doctors, they'll go to the surgeons, they'll go to everywhere, my body is now falling apart, please do something. Okay, within reason, fine, do that. But you know, my whole life is devoted to keeping my body going, and I'm going to have to leave it. Then, if my efforts are only aimed at keeping myself in excellent body condition at the cost of everything else, I don't care as long as I'm enjoying, then you are back in that hole. I'm doing yoga, I'm keeping myself young, I'm taking some Ayurvedic medicine, I'm taking this one, I'm taking that one, I'm doing meditation. So all that, what is the purpose of it? So if the purpose is not to discover yourself or to have that realization of yourself and be situated in the self, you are just a fake yogi. You're not achieving anything. You are so-called yogi. May not be entirely fake, but you're so-called. So-called means fake, actually. It's a polite word.
So many times I also noticed that when I was desiring something for people, actually I was cunningly only wanting them to be spiritually elevated. I never actually wanted them to get sincerely what they were all wishing, or they would ring me up, or they would talk about their issues, or I would see them in some pain. And after a long time I realized that actually I was always asking for this only, that eventually it's such a waste to go out going crazy about either health or wealth or any.
Why were you so overly concerned about the others?
I told you that when I had that phase where I was just very bothered that what sometimes so much effort is made to just wish for something, and then I was noticing and looking at them and said it's such a waste. I wish it was on the other path, which would anyway be more purposeful, most probably, because...
But that's the way they will get there. That's the way they will get there, just the way you got there. You're forgetting your own time. You also came to this path out of pain, out of some lack. So everyone comes to this path through that only.
Underlining, I remember mostly I was always bothered about this only. I, in fact, bothered about what is this only?
My liberation problem
was always there. I was saying that I'm doing wrong thing, I've come here to do all, I'm doing all the wrong things. Mom had to keep on telling me, no, get into the material thing, you are just wasting your time. So I remember when I was young only, the moment I see a Babaji is run out there, so she had to bring me, she never let me go to anybody.
So that is past in previous sanskars, you know, the previous impressions on your soul.
Yeah, and it was very painful because I used to wonder, what am I doing here? This is all wrong, and I should never enjoy what I used to have.
Well, Krishna is explaining this in 15.9. He says that just as, you know, your mind, intelligence, false ego, your impressions of the previous life, after you leave this body, go to the next body, and they are acting there. So then there is a natural attraction towards a particular aspect. Yes.
Because I remember I heard of you when we had gone for a honeymoon. So I met that girl, Anupama, who is also from here. And I was so kicked. I said, come on, let's go back. I finally found what I want. How did I know? I didn't even know. So after so many years, you are...
So you get the arrangement, you know, the arrangement, divine arranges for all this.
Like as if I knew it was you, I had to come here. And I said, oh, this is it. How can a 2-page of reading that book, not even the whole thing. And I was so agitated. I said, I have to go back down. I have to go. And it was 2 weeks when we came down. And I see now the journey that... I am really blessed. I have tenfold blessings. You, that I know who Krishna is. Both healing blessings I have, Lekhi and the Lekhi both. I have the inclination, I must say, of wanting at least very badly this ultimate thing. So through that I was just noticing, I think mindset and environment, God gave me that too. I think that's such a blessing.
Good. You are feeling good about your life is important. That you are balancing both the spiritual requirements and the material requirements. So both need to be balanced, yes. Any other question? We can conclude otherwise. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय,
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय,
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय,
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
So we have completed text 14 of chapter 15, and next time we will take it up from 15:15. Okay, thank you for coming. See you next week.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.
You've been listening to Nalin Kanarula on GettingPositiveKarmaNow.com.